Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us again on another edition of the Spokane Valley Fire Department's Medic Monday. Today's topic, we're going to talk about opiates, opioid molecule, and overdosing, kind of specifically. Did you know that it is a myth that only druggies overdose on hard drugs? It's just factually untrue. Fact is, we respond often to very regular people that experience an overdose on prescription medication. Okay, prescription opioid medication is by far more common for us. Per the Mayo Clinic, what is an opioid? An opioid is a broad group of pain-relieving drugs that work by interacting with the opioid receptor in your cells. So, cells, cellular biology, and the microcellular biology that some of this understanding of how the opioid molecule works is so far beyond where I think we're going to go today that we're going to take a more kind of broad look at what a cell or receptor is and stuff like that. So how about this? Let's think of the cells as basically circular, some level of protein sheathing over the top, and on top of that sheathing is all these different receptors. These receptors are all jagged and have very specific shapes. The idea being that pharmaceutically, we create chemicals that only interact at that receptor for only the promoted effect. That's what we try to do with opioids in our country. So one thing to consider is, in the United States of America, we've pretty much made our bed with opioids as being our pain control method, okay? Good, bad, or indifferent, it is what it is. So what does the opioid actually do? Right, so we talked about the cell, we talked about having some level of receptor on it. So the opioid chemical, right, at its cellular level is swimming through your bloodstream and it's trying to find your cell's receptor that is essentially your pain receptor. And that pain receptor, we've customized the opiate to find that shape and link onto it. And basically what the opioid then does is it muffles the perception of pain in your body while also producing a pleasure, kind of boost your feelings effect. Not your emotional feelings, but like the feeling, sensation of pleasure. Okay, that's good and that's bad, because the good is we wanted to take away the pain. The bad is we kind of gave a byproduct of giving you this good sensation, this good feeling. And you could be thinking like, well, what do you mean? Or that sounds great to me. Hey, when was the last time you took you had a sore throat and you took some cough medicine? When was the last time you went back for seconds? Do you know what I mean? Like that cough medicine is so nasty that it gives you the effect, it soothes your throat, but there's no pleasure boost on it. Does that make sense? Like opioids are kind of weird in that regard. Not only do they do the effect of muffling pain, but they give you this pleasure boost. And we're gonna talk about that because that's actually something that's causing quite a bit of an addiction. How does it actually stop our pain? Well, as described, it inhibits the receptor at the nerve cell. It blocks the sensation of pain. That's the opioid kind of fitting onto that receptor. That's what it's trying to do. And that's a good thing for us. That helps. That's how a lot of us are able to survive through massive surgery, that the pain would be unbearable otherwise, is we're getting those pain cells blocked so that you can promote some healing. All right, so why is it so easy to abuse? Well, let's go back to what we kind of talked about. We just talked about that not only does it block your pain, but it also gives you this kind of boost of good feeling, okay? Well, at lower doses, the opioid, it can make you a little drowsy, maybe make you a little sleepy, stuff like that, probably blocks your pain as it's supposed to. But at higher doses, it actually can slow your breathing, slow your heart rate, and make you kind of so overly fixated on this pleasure boost that you're getting that you can actually start to experience respiratory drive depression and not necessarily have the wherewithal or thinking to do what you need to do about it. Does that make sense? Like your body is so fixated with the pleasure boost that it's getting now that the pain has been mitigated that it doesn't want to give up the pleasure boost. So the feelings of pleasure that result from taking an opioid can make you want to continue to experience those feelings even at the detriment to your own body, a decreased respiratory drive. Unfortunately, it's also probably the number one thing that's leading you towards addiction to some degree is whatever chemically is going on that's giving you that dramatic pleasure boost is more than likely what a lot of us are searching for when you're trying to find something outside the spectrum of the medication as far as how it feels. Okay, we're going to talk about abuse in just a moment. So who's the most common to abuse? Well, like I mentioned before, it's not necessarily who you think. In my personal and professional experience, for every one time there's somebody with a needle in their arm out behind a trash bin on the side of the road or whatever, which is real, unfortunately, that does happen in our area with hardcore illicit drug use. More often than not, I go to people that have forgotten whether they took their morning pain med and now it's nighttime. They forgot whether they took their nighttime and now they took a second nighttime and now they're starting to have some of that respiratory drive effect and suppression that we don't want from this drug, and we come in to try to help mitigate that effect, okay? But it's oftentimes, it's people, normal people on prescription level drugs that are overcome or get led down the road to abuse, okay? What are some of the most common opioids used today? These are the first 10 or 15 that I could find, okay? But these, I bet you most of us have heard a lot of these. Hydrocodone, morphine, hydromorphone, codeine, Oxycontin, Demerol, Fentanyl, Lortab, Norco, Vicodin, Dilaudid. Dilaudid's a huge one out there. Methadone for people coming off of heroin. You could get put on a methadone clinic, which is a way of trying to step down your body's need for that drug. Methadose, oxycodone. I'm sure there's more out there. Okay, not a single one of these is an illicit drug that I'm talking about street abuse. I'm talking every one of these drugs right here is probably given to somebody for the right reason as a prescription. And this is what we find very commonly abused. So how does somebody overdose on an opioid and what does it actually do? Okay, so by taking more than your cells can actually handle, generally the prescribed amount, you know, that prescribed amount is gained through literature of saying, hey, for this type of injury, most people's pain can be mitigated, not eliminated, but mitigated with this amount of this type of opioid. Okay, so the numbers have been generated for kind of with a reason that this type of injury generally needs this type of medical benefit in order to take away the pain. But what if you take more than that? Well, if you take more than what you're prescribed, you're already leading yourself down just a little bit of a slippery slope of allowing yourself to abuse. But secondly is this. Once your cell is saturated, once that pain receptor cell is saturated, and you've still got leftover opioid floating through your bloodstream, it now becomes like this kind of free radicalized chemical that is now going to have unplanned effects, right? As it tries to get processed through your bloodstream, but has nowhere to go where it was supposed to go, okay? Those unplanned effects are stuff like central nervous system depression and a decrease of respiratory drive because the sensation of pleasure is so intense that your body kind of says, you know what, I'd rather us be focused brain power on this pleasure feeling, and I'll breathe when I can. Truthfully, many of us have been on scene where we've seen somebody who's overdosed and you're watching their respiratory rate actually decrease. You know, it can happen precipitously. So, what do you do? What can you do if you think somebody is having an opioid overdose? Okay, number one is you need to get we need to get that respiratory drive established right away. So the best thing you can do for them is call 911 right away. Narcan is a method that we're going to use, the naloxone, and that's this product right here. You see this common. Naloxone or Narcan is simply a reversing agent for an opiate. It not only will disrupt it from the cell, but it'll block it from doing its job pain relief wise on the cell. So that's important to understand, because if I give this to somebody, I'm A, gonna take away their high, if that's what the effect was that they're going for, but B, I'm also gonna take away some of that pain relief that they had. So it's very likely that the person that is awakened through a full administration of Narcan, they're gonna wake up in pain, sick, nauseous, irritable, and potentially very lucid, and this is somebody that maybe didn't want to be lucid, okay? So there's an attitude issue already, as well as a behavioral issue, as well as is it really my job to eliminate your experience? That's not my lane, okay? My my job is to try to reestablish your respiratory drug. And truthfully, that's what this product is attempting to do. So how commonly are you gonna see this item administered? The police officers are some of the most prevalent carriers and users of Narcan. They've been trained on the benefits of this product and how to use it. And I'm gonna show you the way that you're commonly gonna see it used both in hospitals and out potentially in the field. This is called a mucosal atomizing device. What this little doohickey does is it basically, when the liquid is pushed up into here, it forces it to not spray out in a stream, but to spray out in a mist. And I'm gonna try to demo that for us. We're gonna put this up into the nair. The inside of your nares are incredibly vascular, which is why you can cut the inside of your nose really easy and get nosebleeds really easy. Well, we're gonna understand that, and we're gonna use this to our advantage, okay, on the body. I'm gonna put about half a dose on either side, so I try to saturate as much of the inside nares as possible and get it into your vascular system, as quick as possible. This is very effective. It's very fast. 30 to 60 seconds, we will see an onset. Unfortunately, though, the opposite is true. This thing wears off incredibly quick as well, which means that though I might successfully give it to you, let's use a real life example. Let's say somebody had an actual addiction to heroin and I'm trying to treat them. That heroin's gonna last for hours, hours and hours and hours. This is gonna wear off somewhere in the 10 to 20 minutes range. So there's no chance that this is your cure. This is a stopgap. This will help us reintroduce a drive for the respiratory system as we try to get you to the hospital, because ultimately it's gonna be a slow process to kind of allow you to come out of an illicit or hard drug abuse situation and still somehow get out of there without having DTs or delirium tremens or withdrawal effects and stuff like that. Okay, so again, to reiterate, my goal isn't necessarily to make you lucid instantly. My goal of this is to try to get the respiratory drive reestablished. Okay, so if we can see it, and I'm gonna waste the whole amount because I want us to see it, but I want you to see how it misses. And hopefully we caught that. And again, aggressively put into both nares, you're gonna get a lot of that product actually gets into your vascularity. Okay, so again, what is Narcan's goal? Narcan's goal isn't to lucidly wake you up. It's not like it is on Pulp Fiction where somebody stabs somebody through the heart with the adrenaline needle and gets them to pop back up. That's not at all what we're going for. We're trying to reestablish the body's want to respirate and breathe on its own in lieu of the fact that it's being intensely challenged by this pleasure sensation, okay? So the ultimate goal is to start that respiratory drive immediately. Can you do this necessarily on an individual basis? Probably not. I mean, I can't do it either unless I have this medication with me. So 911 is ultimately what you're gonna have to do to advocate for this patient. All right, it's been a complex topic. We've only brushed the surface of it. I hope this has given us at least a little bit of education on what an opioid molecule is, what it's doing, what it's trying to do in your body, what it inadvertently is doing in your body, and what we can do to try to reverse that. Check us out for another lesson, and we're gonna continue this type of, this concept as we talk about pain, pain threshold, and pain tolerance, and how you can go about understanding pain in your body. This is the Spokane Valley Fire Department signing off, hoping that you can have a great 2021, and I'm wishing you to be well and be happy.